Yodanandana Braja Janaranjana Yashodanandana Braja Janaranjana Yamuna Tira Vanachari Yamuna Tira Vanachari Jai Radha Madhava Kunj Bihare Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivar Dhari Jai Radha Madhava Kunj Bihare Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivar Dhari Yashodanandana Braja Janaranjana Yashodanandana Braja Janaranjana Yamuna Tira Vanachari Yamuna Tira Vanachari Jai Radha Madhava Kunj Bihare Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivar Dhari Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jaya Gandharvika Giri Dhare, Gandharvika Giri Dhare Gaura Hari. Jaya Lakshmi Narasimha Jaya Ananta Dev. Lakshmi Narasimha Jaya Ananta Dev. Jaya Jaya Prabhupad, Prabhupad, Prabhupad. Jaya Prabhupad. Nitai Gaura Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. Nitai Gaura Hari Bol.
To announce that in Kannada. That they won't understand.
ಓಂ ಜ್ಞಾನ ತಿಮಿರಾಂಧಸ್ಯ ಜ್ಞಾನಾಂಜನ ಶಲಾಕಯ ಚಕ್ಷುರೋನ್ಮೀಲಿತಂ ಯೇನ ತಸ್ಮೈ ಶ್ರೀಗುರವೇ ನಮಃ. ಶ್ರೀಚೈತನ್ಯಮನೋಭೀಷ್ಟಂ ಸ್ಥಾಪಿತಂ ಯೇನ ಭೂತಲೆ ಸ್ವಯಂ ರೂಪ ಕದಾ ಮಹ್ಯಂ ದದಾತಿ ಸ್ವಪದಾಂತಿಕಂ. ವಂದೇಹಂ ಶ್ರೀಗುರುಃ ಶ್ರೀಯುತಪದಕಮಲಂ ಶ್ರೀಗುರುನ್ ವೈಷ್ಣವಾಂಶ್ಚ ಶ್ರೀರೂಪಂ ಸಾಗ್ರಜಾತಂ ಸಹಗಣರಘುನಾಥಾನ್ವಿತಂ ತಂ ಸಜೀವಂ ಸಾದ್ವೈತಂ ಸಾವಧೂತಂ ಪರಿಜನಸಹಿತಂ ಕೃಷ್ಣಚೈತನ್ಯದೇವಂ ಶ್ರೀರಾಧಾಕೃಷ್ಣಪಾದಾಂ ಸಹಗಣಲಲಿತಾ ಶ್ರೀವಿಶಾಖಾನ್ವಿತಾಂಶ್ಚ. ನಮಃ ಓಂ ವಿಷ್ಣುಪಾದಾಯ ಕೃಷ್ಣಪ್ರೇಷ್ಠಾಯ ಭೂತಲೆ ಶ್ರೀಮತೆ ಭಕ್ತಿವೇದಾಂತಸ್ವಾಮಿನಿತಿ ನಾಮಿನೇ. ನಮಸ್ತೆ ಸಾರಸ್ವತೆ ದೇವೇ ಗೌರವಾಣಿ ಪ್ರಚಾರಿಣೆ ನಿರ್ವಿಶೇಷ ಶೂನ್ಯವಾದಿ ಪಾಶ್ಚಾತ್ಯ ದೇಶ ತಾರಿಣೆ ವಾಂಛಾಕಲ್ಪತರುಭ್ಯಶ್ಚ ಕೃಪಾ ಸಿಂಧುಭ್ಯ ಏವ ಚ ಪತಿತಾನಾಂ ಪಾವನೇಭ್ಯೋ ವೈಷ್ಣವೇಭ್ಯೋ ನಮೋ ನಮಃ. ಜಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ಪ್ರಭು ನಿತ್ಯಾನಂದ ಶ್ರೀ ಅದ್ವೈತ ಗದಾಧರ ಶ್ರೀವಾಸಾದಿ ಗೌರಭಕ್ತವೃಂದ. ಹರೇ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೇ ಹರೇ, ಹರೇ ರಾಮ ಹರೇ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೇ ಹರೇ. ಹರೇ ಕೃಷ್ಣ. ಅ ಹಾರ್ಟಿ ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್ ಟು ಆಲ್ ದ ಡಿವೋಟೀಸ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ ಒಕೇಶನ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಅಪಿಯರೆನ್ಸ್ ಡೇ ಸೆಲೆಬ್ರೇಷನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಲಾರ್ಡ್ ಶ್ರೀ ನರಸಿಂಹದೇವ್. It is on this tithi, many years ago, in Satya Yuga, that the Supreme Lord Shri Krishna appeared in the most wonderful and extraordinary form of Lord Narasimhadev. And since that time, from time immemorial, this festival has been celebrated with great joy and devotion all over the country. Earlier it used to be celebrated all over the planet. Then somehow it got lost, and now by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada, once again it is being celebrated all over the planet. And it is also being celebrated as usual all over the universe. Because at the time of Lord Narasimhadev's appearance, all the demigods were also participating by being witnesses. And then when Lord Narasimhadev appeared, then the demigods came to offer prayers to him. So this was an occasion for celebration throughout the universe. Yesterday morning and evening, as well as this morning, we were discussing some verses from the Srimad Bhagavatam, the 7th canto, the 8th chapter, which specifically deals with the appearance of the Supreme Lord as Narasimhadev. And a brief background for those of you who were not attending or who were not able to attend. You know that Hiranyakashipu and his brother Hiranyaksha were very powerful demons, and they caused a great disturbance in the whole universe. So much so that even the demigods were not able to discharge their functions. In fact, there was great unemployment all over the universe. All the demigods who were in charge of different functions of the universal administration were left without a service, because Hiranyakashipu took over all the work that the devas. They must never send text messages, SMS when the class is going on. No need to look at the phone when the Krishna Katha is going on, Krishna Naam is going on. At least for some time, let us forget our phones. Let us forget the rest of the world. And let us focus only on the devotion to Lord Krishna. So then, even though Hiranyakashipu tried in so many different ways to kill Prahlad, by placing him under the feet of mad elephants, by throwing him into a pit of poisonous snakes, by throwing him from the top of a cliff, by placing him in a pot of boiling oil, and many, many other ways, but Prahlad was never even in the slightest bit injured. And Hiranyakashipu began to get increasingly worried and fearful and anxious. Eventually, when after so many repeated attempts to kill him in different ways emerged unsuccessful, Hiranyakashipu began to panic. And then one day he called his son. And when his son was again talking about Lord Vishnu, in great anger, Hiranyakashipu told him that you are an extremely impudent, arrogant, ignorant, foolish, stupid boy. Because you are not listening to my advice, you think that you are so clever that you can go against my instruction and take shelter of Lord Vishnu, who is my enemy. And Prahlad at that time gave many nice instructions to Hiranyakashipu, which we discussed yesterday and this morning as well. And Prahlad advised his father, "My dear father, do not think in terms of friends and enemies. No one is our friend, no one is our enemy. These distinctions are all a creation of the mind. In reality, who is our friend? Who is our enemy? So therefore, cease to have such inimical ideas towards people. Become a well-wisher of everybody by becoming a devotee of Lord Krishna." Then when Prahlad insisted on speaking like this, Hiranyakashipu became extremely angry. And as he was speaking to Prahlad, berating him, chastising him for speaking about such strange ideas as controlling the mind and controlling the senses and becoming a devotee of Lord Krishna, then Hiranyakashipu saw that Prahlad was not looking at him, but rather that he was looking at a pillar. And when he saw that, he said, "Prahlad, you arrogant, impudent boy, you dare to speak of some lord other than me? Yastvaya mandabhagyokto mad anyo jagatishwaraha. Oh unfortunate one, mandabhagya, you dare to speak about a lord other than me? You don't know how powerful I am? Even the demigods tremble at the very mention of my name. And yet, you are speaking about some other god called Vishnu or Krishna? Kva asau? Where is that lord of yours? I want to see him. Yadi saha sarvatra." You are saying he is everywhere. But yadi saha sarvatra, if indeed he is everywhere, kasmat stambhena drishyate, why do I not see him in this pillar here? You are staring at this pillar. So I want to know, if the Lord that you proclaim to be supreme, that you are so fond of, that he is everywhere, yadi saha sarvatra, then why is he not present here in the pillar before me? Kasmat stambhe na drishyate. He should be everywhere. Because, O Prahlad, you are speaking so much nonsense, I shall now sever your head from your body. Now let me see your most worshipable Lord come to protect you. I want to see this happening. So Hiranyakashipu was challenging God to come and protect his devotee. As we were discussing this morning, for the Supreme Lord, protecting his devotee
caring for them, giving them shelter and affection is more important to him than to kill demons like Hiranyakashipu or Ravan, Hiranyaksha, etc. Although the Lord does personally kill these demons when he descends here, Vinashaya Chadushkritam, but actually his real purpose is Paritranaya Sadhunam. He comes here for the protection of the devotees, of the saintly people, of those who are truly cultured. But because it is required to kill the demons to protect the devotees, therefore as an incidental thing he kills the demons. But his primary purpose is that he comes out of love for his devotee. And now that Hiranyakashipu is challenging God, let me see, O Prahlad, where is that worshipable Lord of yours? And Prahlad was actually seeing Lord Narasimha Dev within the pillar. Only he was able to see. Nobody else was able to see. Many times people challengingly ask the question, can you show me God? One time I was at an airport and these two young girls came. They must have been only 14, 15 years of age, or roughly thereabouts. They saw me in these clothes and they came and asked, can you prove that God exists? Can you show us God? So I said, yes, but you must have the eyes to see him. Do you have the eyes to see? No. I asked them, can you see the microbes and the germs with your eyes? They said, no, but we can see it with a microscope. I said, correct. So just as you need a microscope to see very small things, you cannot see them with your eye. Just as you need a telescope to see many distant objects in this space far, far away, and these are just material things. So why do you think you should be able to see God with these material eyes made of flesh and blood and so on? What is the capacity of these eyes to see? At this moment, if all the lights are switched off and there is no moonlight or sunlight, then we will not even be able to see the hands in front of our eyes, what to speak of anything else. So why are we so proud of our eyes? Why do we assume that seeing is believing? Why do we think that if we can't see something with our eyes, then it cannot exist? That is also something that is unreasonable. So yes, you can see God, but you must develop the eyes to see God. The eyes to see God will come when you serve God, when you listen to the instructions of God in the scriptures like the Bhagavad Gita and the Srimad Bhagavatam. And by hearing, you will get knowledge of who is God, who am I, what is this world. And then you will also understand how to serve the Supreme Lord and why to serve Him. And when you begin to serve the Lord, automatically everything will appear, everything will manifest. Ataha Shri Krishna Namadi na bhavet grahyam indriyai sevon mukhehi jivvado svayam eva spuratyadau. So in this verse it is mentioned that one cannot understand all the attributes of God, like His name, His abode. One cannot see His form, etc., with these eyes, with these gross bodily senses. But when we engage these senses in the service of the Supreme Lord Shri Krishna, then automatically the senses and the mind become purified. And with those purified, spiritualized eyes and senses, then we can perceive the Lord in the heart. And some fortunate, exalted devotees like Prahlad can actually see the Lord face to face. It is not such a cheap thing that we should just demand, show me God. Today, if I demand sitting here, show me the President of India, let him appear before me, will the President of India come? Will the Prime Minister of India come? No. Even your child will not come. You keep calling, come here, child says, no, I don't want to come. Then why should you expect that the Lord should come? Just because you want to see Him? We have to be qualified to see God. Then the Lord will happily appear. It is only love that will bring the Lord in front of us, not anything else, not our material intelligence, not our wealth, not our name and fame and beauty. No material quality attracts the Lord. The only quality that attracts the Supreme Lord is pure devotion. And when that devotion comes in the heart of the devotee, then Lord Krishna is helplessly attracted, so much so that the devotee becomes even more powerful than the Supreme Lord. And like Mother Yashoda did in Vrindavan, the devotee can even bind Lord Krishna. But the binding of Lord Krishna is done not simply by rope, but it is by love. It is because of the love of Mother Yashoda that she was able to bind Krishna with rope. Otherwise, there is no question of any rope being able to bind Krishna. So because Prahlad had that heart that was full of devotion, full of bhakti, therefore the Lord was obliged out of love to appear exclusively to Prahlad and to nobody else. So today, if the Lord wants to appear physically here and appear to somebody amongst us who may be a very, very pure devotee, maybe that only one person will see Him and nobody else will see Him. The Lord reserves the right to make Himself visible to whoever He chooses. And He has the power to make Himself invisible to anyone else. He will only select those who are qualified. So Hiranyakashipu was unqualified to see God, but he had one qualification that was very, very great. What was that qualification? He was the father of Prahlad. Even though he harassed and troubled Prahlad so much, because the Lord loved Prahlad, he appeared before Prahlad. And in order to save Prahlad, he also had to show himself to Hiranyakashipu. So Hiranyakashipu was fortunate that he could ultimately get to see the Supreme Lord in the form of Lord Narasimha Dev. So when Prahlad was looking at the pillar and Hiranyakashipu challenged him that, I want to see how your Lord will come and save you. Now with my sword in hand, I am about to sever your head from your body. Let me see how the Lord will come and save you. And in this way, Hiranyakashipu was roaring in great anger and cursing his son again and again. Hiranyakashipu took up his sword and with great might, with great force, he struck that pillar with his fist. Hiranyakashipu was extremely strong, and when he struck the pillar, it was a very strong blow. And then something very spectacular happened, something very unprecedented happened. There was, what happened? Let us hear in the words of Shukadev Goswami what happened. Then from within the pillar came a fearful sound which appeared to crack the covering of the universe. This sound reached even the abodes of the demigods like Lord Brahma. And when the demigods heard it, they thought, oh, now our planets are being destroyed. So such a loud, terrific sound emerged. So much so that even the demigods in the higher planets began to tremble in fear. And their thoughts, now is the end of the universe. Our planets are going to get destroyed. Just as when there is loud thunder, there are loud claps of thunder, what to speak of children, even adults tremble a little bit. Does it happen or not? Immediately some kind of sensation runs through the body. And at the back of the mind, we think, oh, I hope we are not going to get destroyed by this thunder. So similarly, this sound reverberated throughout the universe, and the demigods also began to be fearful. While showing his extraordinary prowess, Hiranyakashipu, who desired to kill his own son, heard that wonderful tumultuous sound which had never before been heard. Upon hearing the sound, the other leaders of the demons were afraid. None of them could find the origin of that sound in that assembly. And then this verse that is up on the board was spoken. Narad Muni is actually speaking this to King Yudhishthir, because Yudhishthir has wanted to know the story of Prahlad and Narasimha Dev. So Narad Muni, who was the guru of Prahlad, he started explaining this story. So in the course of that narration, now this verse has been spoken, a very beautiful verse which explains why the Supreme Lord appeared, and indeed why he appeared in such an extraordinary way from within a pillar. So let us recite this verse. So kindly repeat after me.
Satyam vidhatum nijabhritya bhashitam. Vyaptim cha bhuteshu akhileshu chatmanah. Adrishyatat yad bhutarupam udvahan. Stambe sabhayam na mrigam na manusham. Satyam vidhatum nijabhritya bhashitam. Vyaptim cha bhuteshu akhileshu chatmanah. Adrishyatat yad bhutarupam udvahan. Stambhe sabhayam na mrigam na manusham. Satyam vidhatum. Satya means true. Vidhatu means to prove. To prove what? Nijabhritya bhashitam. Nijabhritya. Bhritya means a servant, a devotee. Bhashitam means the words. So to prove that the words of his devotee were true. Which words?
Vyaptim cha bhuteshu akhileshu cha atmanah. That the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna or Sri Vishnu, is all pervasive. He is everywhere present in every atom and also in the heart of every living entity. In order to prove that the statement of his dear devotee Prahlad, that the Lord is present everywhere, what happened? Adrishyata. Therefore, the Lord was seen. And what way was he seen? Ati adbhuta rupam. He was seen in this most extraordinary form. Adbhuta means wonderful, extraordinary form. Udvahan means he took. So the Lord took this most extraordinary form. And Stambhe, in the pillar, Sabhayam, in the assembly hall of Hiranyakashipu, he took a form that was na mrigam, not an animal, na manusham, not a human being. So he assumed a form that was neither human nor animal. But he was half lion, half man. So therefore, to convince Hiranyakashipu that the words of the devotees are always correct, the Lord appeared through the pillar. Otherwise, he could have appeared from anywhere. But because Prahlad was looking at the pillar, he wanted to demonstrate that indeed the Lord is actually everywhere. Now, the pillar had already been constructed. How is it that the Lord entered the pillar? Because he's already there. He's already there in every atom. And then for the Lord to manifest anywhere in the creation is not at all a difficult task, because the whole creation is simply a manifestation of his own material energy. This material energy is always under the control of the Lord. So it was an easy thing for the Lord to appear in any way he liked, in any form he liked, in any manner he liked, because he is supreme. For us, it is very extraordinary. When the Lord builds a bridge across the sea to Lanka and floats big stones, it is very extraordinary for us. But not for God. He is floating billions of planets in space. So what is difficult for the Lord in floating some stones on the water? Similarly, for the Lord to appear from within a pillar may seem extremely odd and strange and extraordinary for us. But for the Lord, it is not at all something difficult. And he also wanted to reassure his devotee, Prahlad. Don't worry, Prahlad. Your father cannot harm you even one bit. I am there with you. I am there for you to protect you. In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna asks Arjuna to promise, Kaunteya pratijanihi name bhaktah pranashyati. Oh, Kaunteya, Arjuna, please declare boldly to the whole world that my devotee will never perish. So Lord Krishna repeatedly in the Bhagavad Gita promises protection to his devotees who surrender to him and who constantly serve him with devotion. So here, by this most wonderful appearance, Lord Narasimhadev has sent a message to both the devotees as well as the demons. To the demons, he has sent a message that I exist. Even though you deny my existence, but I am very much present. And not only am I am present everywhere, in every living entity's heart, in every atom, and I can appear from anywhere and everywhere as per my sweet will. And to the devotees, he reinforces the faith of the devotee that he is indeed present everywhere and that he will always keep his promise to protect his devotees. It is because of this faith in Lord Krishna's repeated promises in this regard that devotees become truly fearless, as indeed Prahlad was. Even when Hiranyakashipu was trying to kill Prahlad in so many ways, Prahlad was not panicking at all. He didn't shout, police, police. He didn't shout for the doctors. He didn't shout for the lawyers. He didn't even shout for God. Oh God, please save me. He never once said that. He simply closed his eyes and meditated upon the beautiful form of Lord Krishna. And that gave him so much peace and joy and fearlessness. He didn't even want to trouble God, please come and save me. Because he had the faith that this body, like the whole world, belongs to Krishna. If Lord Krishna wants to destroy it, it is his property. Who am I to protest? And if Lord Krishna wants to protect my body, which is his property, then who can destroy my body? So either way, why should I panic? Why should I worry? This kind of faith and understanding and devotion brings complete fearlessness to the devotee. Bhajahure mana Sri Nandanandana Abhaya Charanaravindare. As a great Vaishnava poet has sung, instructing his own mind, O my dear mind, please worship the lotus feet of Radha and Krishna, because this will award you true fearlessness within this world. And Hiranyakashipu looked all around to find out the source of this noise. He could not understand where is the sound coming from. The origin of that sound could not be traced. And then that wonderful form of the Lord emerged from the pillar. And Hiranyakashipu gazed at this in amazement and wonder. And he began to think, what is this creature that has come out of the pillar that is half lion and half man? He had never before seen such a creature. He had seen a human being and he had seen a lion. But he had never seen a form of a half lion and a half human. And with this kind of shrieking sounds, that the roaring sounds that the lion, half man was making, was sending shudders through the spine of not only Hiranyakashipu, but also all the assembled demons who were present there in their thousands. This terrifying sound was reverberating throughout the universe. Hiranyakashipu paused for a few moments and tried to study this form that he had never seen before, and trying to decide, who is this who is present in front of me? And Narad Muni describes the description, or rather he gives the appearance of Lord Narasimhadev. The Lord's form was extremely fearsome because of his angry eyes, which resembled molten gold. His shining mane, which expanded the dimensions of his fearful face. His deadly teeth, his razor-sharp tongue, which moved about like a dueling sword. His ears were erect and motionless, and his nostrils and gaping mouth appeared like caves of a mountain. His jaws parted fearfully, and his entire body touched the sky. His neck was very short and thick, his chest broad, his waist thin, the hairs on his body as white as the rays of the moon. His arms, which resembled flanks of soldiers, spread in all directions as he killed the demons, rogues and atheists with his conch shell, disc, club, lotus and other natural weapons. And then Hiranyakashipu understood, this is Lord Vishnu, who has appeared in this strange form in order to kill me, but he will not be able to kill me. I am supremely powerful. What can this Lord Vishnu do? Let him appear in whatever form he wants, half lion, half human, whatever he wants. Let him use whatever weapons he wants, but he will not be able to kill me. I am perfectly powerful enough and capable enough of protecting myself. This is the pride and the arrogance of those who are demoniac. Low battery here. It's going to get disconnected. So Prahlad, this is the situation of atheistic people like Hiranyakashipu, who do not imagine that they can ever be destroyed by the material nature. And just as a small insect falls forcefully into a fire, and the insignificant creature becomes invisible, so Hiranyakashipu rushed at Narasimhadev, who was effulgent like the blazing fire, and it appeared like a moth or a little creature had entered into the fire in the form of Lord Narasimhadev. Thereafter, Hiranyakashipu, who was actually a great warrior, very powerful warrior, he began to attack the Supreme Lord with his sword, with his club and various weapons. And he would fly, attack, and then move away, up in the sky, down in the sky, left and right, backwards and forwards. He was a very expert warrior. But what good is all this expertise in front of the Supreme Lord? This expertise has some value in front of human beings. When a firefly appears in the night, it appears very bright and attractive. How many of you have seen a firefly? And if you have seen many fireflies together, then at night the vision appears very attractive. But when the sun rises, what happens to the attraction or attractiveness of the firefly? Nobody can see the firefly. So the firefly is noticeable only so long as there is no sun. Once even the faint glimmer of the rays of the sun come, then the firefly's value becomes zero. Similarly, so long as the Supreme Lord does not appear, then people can think they are very powerful, very strong, and so on. But in front of the Supreme Lord, their power is absolutely negligible and insignificant. And then Hiranyakashipu, however, captured him very easily, just as Garuda might capture a snake. The snakes are food for Garuda, as you know. And then, interestingly, just to make this whole battle a little interesting, Lord Narasimhadev let Hiranyakashipu slip from his grip. Because Lord Narasimhadev also wants to relish the Veera Rasa, the mellow of chivalry. He also wants to fight. He likes to fight, but he cannot fight with any ordinary person. He has to fight with some very, very powerful demon who he himself has to empower. And then he let him go. The moment Hiranyakashipu was released from the grip of Lord Narasimhadev or Hiranyakashipu thought, by my power I have come out of this grip of Hiranyakashipu, of Lord Narasimhadev, and I will emerge victorious, and very soon I will defeat this half man, half lion. And Srila Prabhupada here gives a very interesting purport. He says, sometimes we see that very sinful people, atheistic people, those who speak against God, who trouble the devotees, they appear to prosper. And they appear to have a very good time in this world. They enjoy life. They get high position, they get name, fame, money, prosperity, enjoyment, everything. And poor devotees sometimes suffer. And these sinful people seem to be having a good time. So many people ask this question, why does that happen? And Prabhupada answers, please remember this answer. It is like the Lord letting them play for some time, releasing them. Okay, you play in the darkness for some time, but not for long, then I'll catch you. Then finish, everything is over. So let me read how Prabhupada explains it in his purport. When a sinful man enjoys material facilities, foolish people sometimes think, how is it that the sinful man is enjoying whereas a pious man is suffering? Actually, by the will of the Supreme, a sinful man is sometimes given the chance to enjoy the material world as if he were not under the clutches of material nature, just so that he may be fooled. A sinful man who acts against the laws of nature must be punished. But sometimes he is given a chance to play. Exactly like Hiranyakashipu when he was released from the hands of Narasimhadev. Hiranyakashipu was destined to be ultimately killed by Narasimhadev. But just to see the fun, the Lord gave him a chance to slip from his hands. So Hiranyakashipu took a little rest, took a few moments to breathe. Again he attacked Lord Narasimhadev. And the demigods hiding behind the clouds were getting very anxious because it was becoming dark. And in the darkness, the strength of such people, demoniac people, increases. They don't like the daytime, they like the night. So the demigods were wondering, praying to the Lord, oh Lord, please kill this demon very quickly. And then finally the Lord decided, yes, the time has come. So he captured Hiranyakashipu once again, just as a snake captures a mouse, or just as Garuda captures a snake. Sometimes even a cat or a snake will play with a mouse like this, catch, release, just for some fun. So similarly, the Lord had caught Hiranyakashipu, released him, but now he again caught him. And he lifted him up. He carried him to the doorway. He sat on the stairs. He placed Hiranyakashipu on his lap. And with the tips of his nails, he tore apart the chest of Hiranyakashipu, which was like stone, hard like stone. And then he tore it apart and killed Hiranyakashipu. Tavakara kamalavare nakam adbhuta shringam dalita Hiranyakashipu tanubhringam keshavadrita narahari rupa jaya jagadisha hare. So tavakara kamala vare nakham adbhuta shringam. His hands are so miraculous, so wonderful, that they are like lotuses. But when they touch the chest of Hiranyakashipu, which is like stone, they could even cut that stone very easily. Vajradapi kathorani kusumadapi komalam. So the Lord can be harder than a thunderbolt, he can be softer than a rose or a flower. The same object, that one nail of the Lord, can be soft as a lotus petal or a rose petal. It can also be harder like a thunderbolt to cut open the stone-like chest of Hiranyakashipu. And then the Lord garlanded himself with the intestines of Hiranyakashipu, placed it around his neck. Now why did the Lord kill Hiranyakashipu in such an unusual way? As you all remember, Hiranyakashipu had received a benediction from Brahma. And the benediction was that he would not get killed inside the house or outside the house. He would not get killed by a human or by an animal. He would not get killed by a weapon or by any living person. He would not get killed in the day or in the night. He would not get killed on the water, on the ground, or in the sky. And Hiranyakashipu had made so many conditions because he wanted a backdoor entry into the kingdom of immortality. Because initially he asked Brahma, I want the benediction or the boon of immortality. Brahma said, sorry, wrong number. Even I am not immortal. How can I give you the boon of immortality? Then Hiranyakashipu, thinking himself to be very intelligent, he thought he could get the backdoor entry. He asked for so many conditions. I should not be killed this, with that, at this time or that time. And Brahma said, tathastu, tathastu, tathastu. And then later on, Lord Vishnu, when he came as Narasimha Dev, after killing Hiranyakashipu, he told Brahma, Enri, giving so many benedictions of this sort, you must be careful what kind of boons you are giving. You just give these boons just like that. And then I have to come and take up so many unusual forms, and I have to do so many things to keep your boon intact, because I have to keep your man, keep your prestige. After all, you are the creator of the universe. You are my great devotee. So please be careful before you offer boons to such demoniac people next time. So anyway, so Lord Narasimha Dev appeared as half human, half lion, which means he was neither animal nor human. He killed him at twilight, at dusk, which is neither day nor night. He killed him on the steps of the house, neither indoors nor outdoors. He killed him on his lap, which is neither the ground nor the sky. He killed him with his nails, which is neither dead nor alive, which is neither a weapon nor a living person. In this way, the Lord, who is supremely intelligent and supremely powerful, found a way to keep Brahma's boons intact, and yet he succeeded in killing Hiranyakashipu very easily. All the demigods started showering flowers from the clouds. Of course, many, many thousands of other faithful associates of Hiranyakashipu began to attack Lord Narasimhadev. And Narasimhadev, just with a swipe of his nails, he was killing them by the thousands. His nails are sufficient. And Srila Prabhupada mentions, this godless civilization that we have today, this highly materialistic, atheistic civilization, can also at any time crumble and be devastated just by a flick of the Lord's little finger. So therefore it is in the interest of the whole world to give up this kind of demoniac and atheistic mentality and to surrender to the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna and become his devotees. Then peace and joy can prevail in the whole world. After all the demons had been killed, everyone, including the demigods who had now arrived on the spot, was so terrified by seeing this display of anger that they did not have the courage to come in front of the Lord. Lord Narasimhadev is the personification of anger. How many of you get angry? Yes. That is a fact. We all get angry. And how many times you feel, I wish I did not get angry? When anger goes out of control. So one time one devotee asked Srila Prabhupada, that how do I control my anger? So Prabhupada replied, think of Lord Narasimhadev when he is angry. And then you will forget your anger. So he is the ultimate personification of anger. No one can have anger like him. So when Lord Narasimhadev's anger was still boiling over, even after killing Hiranyakashipu and his associates, he was still very, very angry. Why was the Lord so angry? How dare Hiranyakashipu trouble his dear devotee? Nothing angers the Lord more than when his pure devotees are troubled. So then the Lord's anger was still there very much. So nobody was even extending the courtesy to him to sit down. When somebody comes to your house, you give that person a place to sit, isn't it? Now the Lord was a guest and he had arrived in the palace of Hiranyakashipu. But everybody was so terrified now, whoever was remaining, including the demigods who had just arrived, nobody even thought of asking him to sit down. They were so scared. So Lord thought, okay, nobody is asking me to sit, let me help myself. So Lord went and sat down on the throne and he was still roaring and roaring. Have you seen the picture or a video of a lion roaring? It can be very terrifying. What does a lion do? The lion raises his head and roars in defiance. The lion will not roar with the head down like that. The lion will roar, keep his head up and then roar. So Lord Narasimhadev sat down on the throne, raised his head and let out long roars. Everybody was trembling even more. And all the demigods wanted to come in front of him to offer prayers, but they were all trembling in fear looking at this terrible form of the Lord, this anger. Then finally, when nobody had the courage, Lord Brahma told Prahlad, Prahlad, you please go, go, go. You go in front. We can't face Lord Narasimhadev, but he has come to protect you. You go in the front. Prahlad was completely fearless. He went in the front with folded hands. And as soon as Lord Narasimhadev saw Prahlad, his anger immediately came down. And his angry expression turned to a very loving, kind expression. And then he placed his hand on Prahlad's head. And then he took Prahlad on his lap. And then what did he do? He began to lick him all over the body, because the top part of the body is lion, right? So animals usually express their affection by licking their young ones, whether it's a cow or a cat or even a dog or a lion. So animals usually do that. So the Lord had taken the form of a half lion. The part, the torso above, was a lion. So he kept Prahlad on his lap and began licking him out of affection. And then he blessed Prahlad. And Prahlad was offering beautiful prayers to him. And the Lord offered him many, many benedictions, even though Prahlad was not keen to have any benediction. Prahlad told the Lord, "Please do not tempt me in this way with this offer of benedictions. I am not a merchant. I am not a businessman who has come to you to strike some deal with you, that in exchange for my worship of you, my service to you, that you should return something to me. My dear Lord, I want nothing from you. You have already given me your darshan. You have given me your bhakti. That is all I need in life." But still the Lord was saying, no, still ask. Then Prahlad asked, "Please give me the association and the opportunity to serve your pure devotees like Narad Muni. That is all I ask." And the Lord happily gave him that. That is the highest benediction we can ask from the Lord. We need not go to the Lord to ask him, "Lord, please give me some money. Please give me a promotion in my job. Please cure me of this or that." No. We should go to the Lord to ask him for the ultimate gift, the ultimate benediction he can give us, which is pure bhakti for him. And therefore Prahlad was now doubly blessed with not just the darshan of the Lord who came to protect him, but also the benediction that he would never fall in maya, that he would constantly serve the Supreme Lord with devotion forever and ever. Shri Narasimha Dev Bhagavan ki jai. Bhakta Raj Prahlad Maharaj ki jai. Shri Narasimha Dev Mahotsav Jayanti Mahotsav ki jai. Gaur Premanande. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. Any announcement now? Oh, please sit down. The program is not over. I'm sorry. Please sit. Please remain.
So he will speak now, right?
Yeah. Very, very good. Hare Krishna. Request all devotees to please. The program hasn't finished yet. His Holiness Bhakti Rasamrta Maharaj will be going down to offer bhoga to their lordship Shishi Lakshmi Narasimhadev. So, while that is being done, we will also be having the curtains open here very soon, and then there will be aarti. In the meantime, let us take the advantage of having the association of Satya Gopinath Prabhu also. Now, at this time, at this moment, I would like to, on behalf of Vartha Krishna Prabhu and all the temple devotees of Sri Narasimha Giridhari Mandir, very wholeheartedly, we would like to thank His Holiness Bhakti Rasamrta Maharaj for having accepted the invitation and having come here for the Brahmotsav and the appearance day of Lord Narasimhadev. We are so very, very fortunate that Maharaj has a little soft corner for Lord, for the devotees, and the deities here are so attractive that the Maharaj is attracted to come here to Bangalore. So we would like to express our gratitude to Maharaj by chanting the Hare Krishna mantra before that. Because this was the last program that Maharaj did during this visit till we have his association again. So as a tradition, we have learned, it is through parampara, that we should offer dakshina to a sannyasi when we see a sannyasi. Jai Shishi Gandharvika Giridhari Ki Jai Shriman Mahaprabhu. So we will have Koteshwar Prabhu standing next to Srila Prabhupada. Koteshwar Prabhu is here, this devotee who is now walking up. So he will be standing there. And since this is the last program Maharaj is giving during this visit, so those of you who wish to offer any dakshina, it will be collectively offered to Maharaj. So, and in the meantime, now we request Satya Gopinath Prabhu. A big welcome to Satya Gopinath Prabhu. Hariva! Hariva! Hariva!
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.
gave us the Nama, the Krishna Nama. And by chanting this Krishna Nama, the Arjuna inside our body will be strengthened and nourished. Whereas the Duryodhana, the Hiranyakashipu, and the Ravanasura, etc. will be driven away. This is the power of this mantra. This is the mantra that has been given to us by the Lord in His form as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu.
ఒక రాజ్యంలో విచిత్ర వర్మ అని చెప్పి ఒక రాజు ఉండేవారు. ఆయనకి విచిత్రమైనటువంటి ఒక అలవాటు ఉండేది. ఏంటి అంటే రకరకాల పక్షుల్ని సేకరించి ఒక మంచి ఉద్యానవనం ఒకటి తయారు చేసి ఆ ఉద్యానవనంలో పెట్టి వాటిని పోషించి పెంచి లాలన పాలన చేస్తూ ఉండేవాడు. ఒకరోజు ఏమిటి అంటే ఆయన దర్బార్లో ఉన్నప్పుడు ఒక వ్యక్తి రెండు తలలో ఉన్నటువంటి ఒక హంసను తీసుకొని వచ్చారు. ఆ హంసం తీసుకొని వస్తే రెండు తలలు ఉండేసరికి అందరూ ఆశ్చర్యంగా చూశారు. బంగారు పాత్రలో పాలు తీసుకొచ్చి ఆ హంసం వదిలిపెట్టారు. పెడితే ఒక తలతో పాలు తాగింది, ఇంకో తలతో తాగలేదు. హంస యొక్క ప్రత్యేకత ఏంటి అంటే పాలు నీళ్ళు కలిపిస్తే పాలు మాత్రమే స్వీకరించి నీటిని వదిలేస్తుంది. మన భక్తిలో ఉన్నతంగా ఉన్నటువంటి వ్యక్తులకి పరమహంస అంటారు. ఎందుకంటే వాళ్ళు ఈ ప్రపంచంలో చెడు మంచి రెండు ఉన్నా కానీ మంచిది మాత్రమే స్వీకరించి చెడు వదిలేస్తారు కాబట్టి పరమహంస అంటారు. కానీ మన వల్ల ఏమనుకోవచ్చు అంటే పరమహింస అనుకోవచ్చు.
Prabhu is just testing my attention and patience and memory. So I have faith in this test, but I'll try my best. So there was a king called Vichitra Varma, and he had a strange habit. Vichitra means strange. He would collect all the birds from different parts of the country and keep them in his garden and make them grow. So one day, somebody brought him a very strange swan. This swan had two heads. So the king was fascinated, and then someone comes in and then gives milk to this swan. This swan is drinking milk through only one of its beak, not the other one. Only one thing it uses to drink the milk. So it is mentioned that just as this swan is drinking milk through one beak, that Paramahamsa devotees of the Lord also have similar capacity of, you know, taking, you know, whatever is connected with bhakti and so on. Therefore, Paramahamsas, they pick up bhakti, pick up good things. Hamsa is a quality of separating milk from water. So they pick up the good things. They are called Paramahamsas. But I think we should give a new name to all the other swans in Kali Yuga. We will call ourselves as Paramahamsa. Hamsa.
So, after
that,
100%. So, after that, తీసుకొని తోటలోకి తీసుకుని వదిలేశాడు. అక్కడ కూడా పాలు పెడితే ఒక తలతో పాలు కలుగుతుంది, ఇంకో తలతో వెళ్ళి పురికుండలో ఉండి నీళ్ళు తాగుతాం. ఇతనికి చాలా తంతలు వెళ్ళాడు. అది హంసేంటి మురికి నీళ్ళు తాగడం ఏంటి అని చెప్పి చాలా తంతలు వెళ్తే ఎంత ప్రయత్నం చేసినా మాత్రం ఒక తలతో పాలు కలుగుతుంది, ఒక తలతో మురికి నీళ్ళు తాగుతుంది.
సో దెన్ ద కింగ్ లీవ్స్ లైక్ 200 హంసా ఇన్ ది గార్డెన్ అండ్ దే కంటిన్యూ టు డ్రింక్ మిల్క్. So that the humps are drink milk from only one of its beak. Well, you could use the other beak to drink water from the drain. So the king was really puzzled. He was wondering, what is this? Why is he drinking milk from one beak and the dirty water drain is one from the other beak?
So apda ina announcement chesaru anamata evari ante evaraina kani ee hamsa rendu talalatoni paalu taaginchinatlayite వాళ్ళకి నేను చాలా పెద్ద బహుమతి ఇస్తాను అని చెప్పి చాలా మంది ప్రయత్నం చేశారు. ఎవ్వరు విజయం సాధించలేదు. ఒక వ్యక్తి సుబుద్ధి అని వచ్చాడు. వచ్చి ఆయన ఏమన్నాడు అంటే, నేను దీనికి రెండు తాళ్ళతో కూడా తాళ్ళు తాగిస్తాను, అయితే ఒక నెల రోజులు సమయం కావాలి నాకు అని చెప్పి చెప్పాడు.
సో కింగ్ అనౌన్స్ ఎ కాంపిటీషన్. హి సెడ్ ఇట్స్ దేర్ ఇస్ ఎనీబడీ ఇన్ దిస్ కింగ్డమ్ హూ కెన్ మేక్ దిస్ వన్ టు డ్రింక్ మిల్క్ ఫ్రమ్ బోత్ ఇట్స్ బీక్. I'll give a special reward. Many people come and try, nobody succeeds. But in that kingdom, there was a person by name Subuddhi. So he comes forward and he says, give me a month's time, I'll make the swan drink from both its beaks.
So, I know.
then months later he comes and then they bring the swan in the palace, in the lord's, in the king's darbar, and he put milk in a golden bowl, and the hamsa, the swan drinks milk from both its feet.
ఎంత
ఎవరు సమర్థ వాడిగా పక్కకి వెళ్ళిపోయి కొంచెం మాస్క్ వేస్తే మొత్తం పక్కకి పడిపోతాడు. అంత బలమైన మొడు పానీయాలు ఎన్ని సేవించినా ఆయన సంతృప్తి లేదు. ఎప్పుడు కూడా భాగవతంలో ఒక స్టేట్మెంట్ దేవుడు అంటే ఎప్పుడు మిట్టుకు పండి ముసలి కొట్టే పాము దాకా అసంతృప్తితో నిట్టుకులు వదులుతూ ఉండేవాడట. ఎన్ని
There's a big contrast between the personality of Prabhu and the personality of Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu was the highest example of lust or passion, highest example, and evil passion. He was always intoxicated, full of pride, arrogance and lust, and he would always be grunting of the pride and alcohol. But Prabhu was exactly the opposite. He was strong, gentle, devoted, and a very sweet person, very sweet boy.
So ikkada manandaram kuda enti ante mini chinna chinna Hiranyakashipu anamata manandar aasa enti ante ee roju naa dikki oka 4 lakhs undi 8 lakhs aithe I'll be happy. 8 16 32 64 128 atla manam calculate chestunta undam rate nen happy undan rate nen happy ga undan kani happiness le tarvata ikkuti man chese mistake enti ante nen suffer avutunnanu itham chaala happy unnadu ayina happy ga unnadu itvanti comparisons untoni asalu present mana chetla unde dali kuda anubhavinchukona jeevitham gadutundam.
What I do nowadays is we always calculating everything in terms of our material possessions or wealth. We have 4 lakhs, we want to make it 8, when we get 8, we want to make it 16. And we keep telling ourselves, okay, when the 16 becomes 32, then I become happy. Then when the 32 becomes 64, 128, like that's our calculation. We're always thinking in terms of multiplying something that can materially and assuming that that is what we will have. But the tragedy and the irony of all this is that we're not able to enjoy what we have in our present. We miss the whole point, we miss the present. We're always thinking, in future, someday I will become happy.
ఒకసారి ఒక జూలో ఒక కాక పుట్టి అట్లా తిరుగుతూ ఉన్నాడు. అది ఒక హంసను చూస్తుంది. చూసి ఆ హంస దగ్గరికి వెళ్ళి, హంస తెల్లగా ఎంత అందంగా ఉన్నావు అని చెప్పాలి. అప్పుడు హంస అనేది నేను అంటే అనుకునేదాన్ని దాని చిలకను చూసిన తర్వాత నాకు అనిపించింది నేను తెల్లగా ఉంటాను ఏం బాగుంటుంది. చిలక రెండు రంగులు ఉంటుంది, ఎరుపు పచ్చ, అది బాగుంటుంది. అప్పుడు ఈ కాక ఏం చేస్తుంది అంటే హంస మధ్య చిలక దగ్గరికి వెళ్ళి చిలక చిలకలు చాలా బాగుంది. నెమలి చూసిన తర్వాత అర్థమైంది రెండే రెండు రంగులు నేను తెలియదు, నెమలి చాలా రంగులు ఉన్నాయని చెప్పి అని పండుగ చిలక. అప్పుడు ఈ కాకి ఏం చేస్తుందంటే చిలక వదిలేసి నెమలి ఆ నెమలి పొడులు గుట్టి నుంచి చేస్తూ ఉంటే అందరూ సెల్ఫీలు తీసుకోవడం, ఫోటోలు అవి ఇవి అప్పుడు ఇవన్నీ చూలో ఉన్నాయి. అందరూ వెళ్ళిన తర్వాత చూ క్లోజ్ అయిపోయిన తర్వాత ఈ కాకి నెమలి దగ్గరికి వెళ్ళి అంటున్నాను నెమలి నెమలి ఎంత అందంగా ఉన్నావు. అప్పుడు ఈ నెమలి ఏమంటుందంటే నేను కూడా అట్లా అనుకుంటూ ఉన్నాను కానీ అందరి ఉపయోగం ఏముంది, ఈ సృష్టిలో ఆనందంగా స్వేచ్ఛగా ఉండేటువంటి పక్షి ఒకే ఒకటి అని నిన్నే నాకు రియలైజేషన్ వచ్చింది. ఎవరు ఆ పక్షి అంటే నువ్వే కాకి. ఎవరైనా నేను భూమిలో పెట్టచ్చు, మమ్మల్ని అందరినీ భూమిలో పెట్టేశారు, నేను ఎవరైనా భూమిలో పెట్టారా.
సో వన్ టైం ఇన్ ఎ జూ దేర్ వర్ మెనీ బర్డ్స్, ఎ క్రో కేమ్ టు ఎ వైట్ స్వాన్ అండ్ ద క్రో జస్ట్ ద స్వాన్ స్వాన్ వాస్ దేర్ ఇన్ ది జూ. Says, see, I'm so black, you're so fair, you're so beautiful, you're so white. And the swan will say, yeah, I also thought I'm so white, it's great, I'm actually pretty lucky. But until I saw a parrot, parrot is more beautiful, so skin colors, nice synchrony in colors, so parrot is more beautiful than me. Then the crow goes to the parrot and says, you're really beautiful, you have so many colors, you know, like that. Then the parrot will say, yeah, that's what I thought about myself until I saw the parrot. When I saw the peacock open up its feathers, then I realized that they can't be a beautiful bird from the peacock. And then they probably go to the peacock and say, you are the luckiest bird. You must be a lucky, you're the prettiest bird. So pretty you are, you open up the whole world and see you. Then peacock is looking at the door and say, yeah, I also thought I was going to be a little bit something about my beauty and all that. But you know something, you are something which is more valuable than what I have. Because I am beautiful, they lock me up in the zoo, in the circle, whatever, in the zoo. In the zoo.
కొడతామని
పాముతో
కనిపిస్తామని
ఎటువంటి
సిచ్యుయేషన్ లో ఉన్నటువంటి ప్రహ్లాదుడు భాగవతం ప్రకారం ఏంటి అంటే ఏదో ప్రసన్న మనసో చాలా నమ్ముకు ముఖాలేనంతో ఉన్నాడు. మనకు అటువంటి సిచ్యుయేషన్ లేకపోయినా కానీ మనం ఎప్పుడు అభద్రత ఇన్సెక్యూరిటీ ఎప్పుడేమైపోతుందో రైట్ ఇన్సెక్యూరిటీ ప్రతి ఒక్కరు అవునా కదా.
What will happen tomorrow? What's going to happen to me? Okay, we have so much fear and insecurity.
So, the reason is that the Prahaladuni Aratata Himsinchanan Muttu Asayikuru Rajasrachi Chattu Unan Emaya, the Muttu Mukharanitam Chusthe Emanke Kastala Petala Anupitsa Kledu Chappala Anupitsa Kledu Me Nana Mata Vinaya Babu Me Nudhulias Babu Lengko Tramasanga Mukku Patsala Vandvandi నేను చంపేయాల్సి వస్తుంది, దయచేసి మా మాట విను బాబు. ఎప్పుడైతే మనం హరే కృష్ణ మహామంత్రం ప్రతి నిత్యం జపిస్తామో జరగబోయేటువంటి పరివర్తన ఏంటి అంటే ఒకరోజు రోజు రోజు పోయే కొద్దీ ఆ ప్రహ్లాదులో ఏ రకమైనటువంటి విశ్వాసం ఉందో ఆ విశ్వాసం మనలో క్రమంగా పెరుగుతూ వస్తుంది. అప్పుడే అన్ని అభద్రతల నుంచి మనం బయటపడేదానికి అవకాశం ఉంది.
Krishna Mahamantra progressively, regularly, every day. A time will come when we will get out of this conception of misery and we will actually be free from such tribulations.
So Bhagavatudu ayana Gitalo spashtanga cheptu unnadu ananya chintayanto mam yajanam paryupasate అన్ని చింతలు విడిచిపెట్టి నా చింతల్లో ఎవరైతే ఉంటారో వాళ్ళ యొక్క యోగక్షేమాలను చూసుకుంటాను. ఈ దీనికి మీ చింతల్లో వచ్చేది ఏంటి అంటే సొల్యూషన్ కాదు, బీపీలు షుగర్ హార్ట్ అటాక్ వస్తాయి.
So this is the actual correct way of becoming free from the material
misery. So manu enti ante association bhaktula yokka sanghatyam dwara aa bhagavantuni patla aa vishwasanni pempudinchukovadaniki manu prayatnam cheyali. Vishwasam gurinchi oka chinna udaharana istanu.
Our job, our real duty, our goal of life is to associate with devotees and develop more faith and conviction in the words and instructions of the scripture. to have faith.
Okkasari oka chinna pillavadu palli namukuntu untadu ani cheppaledu konukune vallanu kuda baaki bayam antu untadu vaallu kalipothu untadu oka bhaktudu chusi chaala mandi adukon tintaru vidu kashtapadutunnadu na digara dabbu undi vidu cheppulu maatrame teesistanu ani cheppi cheppulu konukoni vachi vaadistadu ఆయన చెప్పు ఇచ్చిన వ్యక్తితో ఏమంటాడంటే అయ్యా మీరు భగవంతుడా అని అడుగుతారు. లేదు కాదు నేను భగవంతుడు కాదు అంటే భగవంతుడికి ఏమన్నా ఫ్రెండా అని అడుగుతారు. ఈ ట్రైట్ అడుగుతున్నాము అంటే నిన్నే నా కాళ్ళు కాలిపోతూ ఉంటే భగవంతుడిని చాలా వేడుకున్నాను, నిన్న వేడుకుంటే ఈరోజు మీరు చెప్పు తెచ్చిస్తున్నారంటే మీరు భగవంతుడేమో కాకపోతే అట్లీస్ట్ ఆయన ఫ్రెండ్ ఏమో అని చెప్పి అనుకుంటున్నాను. అంత విశ్వాసం ఉంది నేను ప్రేయర్ చేస్తే ఇమీడియట్ గా రెస్పాన్స్ వచ్చింది అని చెప్పండి.
So after receiving the food fare, the little boy asked that devotee,